And this is one of the big achievements of especially the YPJ and YPG fighting against ISIS. And I think in this struggle, what we have something very deep, natural, which we have to discuss about. I think we cannot be ecologic activists if we don't understand that there is a misunderstanding. We're human beings, we're doing our self-defense as part of this nature. And I think this is something that we're having as a problem if we're discussing tonight. If we still have this distance between us and the nature, we cannot make a struggle which will succeed, because it's a misunderstanding of us having a point, our situation in this world. This is one point. The second point is you raised up the question of power. I think we lost our old trust as ourselves in human beings, and into us as a people, as us as being living people of this world, because the power can only be given to someone if we give it. So if we do not want people to overtake power on us by making papers, they cannot do this. And I think this is also a failure of how we organize ourselves. We're still too much focusing on contracts, papers, and these things. That's not something natural.
I'm going to ask you to please
finish
so we can get.
So the question would be, if we don't want something to happen, and if we say no, we have to think about our methods, about how we organize, how we get together, and how we organize this struggle. And I think this is something that we have to discuss tonight.
Thank you very much.
And this will create unity.
Thank you. Thank you. Would somebody like to make a comment, respond to one of the questions? We just got the mic. Let's be brief so we can try and get as many people before we have to.
Yeah, just on the topic of proportional representation, you know, this is a very challenging campaign here in Canada. Because especially for First Nations peoples, just because, you know, the majority of our population doesn't participate in the federal elections or provincial or municipal elections. You know, in Canada, being a settler colonial state, you know, it says nowhere in our treaties with the Crown that we need to vote in the settler colonial state's elections or affairs. That has no consequence whatsoever on what, you know, our rights are, our collective Indigenous rights are, you know, under law. They're enshrined in the Canadian Constitution, Section 35. There are over 200 Supreme Court decisions that reinforce our collective rights, both our treaty and our inherent rights as Indigenous peoples, as the first peoples of this land. There's our own interpretations of those things. And so, you know, while there are a lot of Indigenous peoples that do participate in the elections, the majority of our peoples don't. We vote for our own Indigenous governments. We have our own Indigenous governments that we vote for, our own laws, you know, sovereignty within a sovereign, I guess you would call it, within a colonial sovereign. And so it's very problematic when you start talking about, like, oh yeah, if we just fixed our democratic system, then everybody would be represented, it would be great. Because basically what that's saying to First Nations peoples is, if you just assimilate and, like, give up your sovereignty and participate in Canadian, you know, governance process, then everything's going to be fair for you. And that's a load of crap. So, it's a really challenging thing when we start generalizing and subscribing to reductionism in this conversation, because it's much more complex than that. When you have a population of Indigenous peoples living in a settler colonial state, where we're talking about, you know, this goal to have proportional representation in the democratic voting system, when you have a population that doesn't vote, you know. So anyway,
Two quick points. One, leading on to the from the proportional representation point, I am from a country that has proportional representation, and it's in many ways not much more substantively democratic. So I wish you the best of luck with the campaign, but don't believe that delivers real democracy. Secondly, the point about the carbon budget. Trudeau won't deliver climate justice. Trudeau won't shut down the extractivist system and strategy that the Canadian government is driving forward. Social movements will do that. And when I'm not jumping up and down on the podium, I'm also a social movement researcher. And social movements don't emerge to fight for numbers. They fight for justice. They fight for land. They fight for water. They fight for survival. So when they get by story and by belief and by solidarity and by social relations, and I don't believe in the magic of numbers. I believe in the magic of movements.
Maybe focus on the question around culture, because that was directed at me. And, I certainly believe that climate change should be understood as a crisis of narrative, of a crisis of culture, that the story of apartness that is at the heart of, what did you call it again?
Psychotic Western Scientific Industrial Experiment.
That story about how we can master nature, its masters and possessors, as Descartes called it, and have this one-way extractive relationship of dominance with the natural world, is the story that is in crisis, and that climate change is essentially a great big message going, you thought you were in charge? Ha ha ha. Every action has a reaction. Sometimes it takes a couple hundred years before the cumulative effect of our actions speaks back to us in the form of storms and fires and droughts. But you know, we are getting a reaction from our action. And when we had our meeting around the Belief Manifesto and tried to create that visioning space as you refer to it, it was really, really, really central to be really humble about the fact that we are not starting from scratch. We are not spinning a brand new story that nobody ever thought of before, right? And Clay, do you want to chime in on this? Because I think there's a really central piece, and for the non-Canadians in the audience, I'm sorry if we're over-Canadizing, but indigenous knowledge and story, right? University of Manitoba, which is, I think, the only university in Canada that now has a mandatory Indigenous studies course that everybody in Canada should be learning about Indigenous culture and narrative and story. It's a tiny piece, right? But I think it's great to something in.
I mean, yeah, I don't know if I'll say what you're hoping I'll say, but I think...
only say what you want to say.
Naomi mentioned Bernie, and, when I think of Bernie, I think of that little bird that landed on his podium there, and some of you might know what I'm talking about. But the thing I appreciate about the Bernie Sanders of the world and about my sister Naomi, and, you know, with her book, This Changes Everything, and Shock Doctrine, and No Logo, is that they mainstreamify, you know, narratives, discourses that social movements have been talking about for a long time, but that have been kept on the fringe by so-called dominant society, okay? And I really think that it's not just social movement change theory that I'm talking about, but also that rich connection to place. You know, a lot of times people, you know, when you go into a church, for example, you'll be like, oh, it's very reverent, and like a church is sacred, there's, you know, God and Jesus and the Holy Ghost are there, so you better be good, you know. And I think for, you know, in Canada, all of these places are sacred, you know, like the rapids that are here on this river, this is a sacred place to the Mohawk people that live here. There are many stories about these rapids that are just here on the river. You know, a lot of history, ancient history. And just because there aren't big temples all over the place up here in northern Canada or in the high Arctic or the Midwest or the Great Plains of the US, these are sacred places with rich history, you know? And the stories of that, you know, are still carried to this day and told to this day by Indigenous peoples who live there, you know, because we're still here. You know, we weren't wiped out. We're not a page in a history book. I'm sitting right here in front of you right now. Yeah. And I think that's the thing, you know, there's a campaign right now that's all going all over the place by some Native folks to rename all the places in Canada according to the Indigenous language that comes from that place. You know, it's decolonization, you know, manifesting before our eyes. And I think that, you know, is the piece that we need, that's missing from our life, is that sacredness, you know, that reverence. You know, and I think that it's through learning about where we call home and the history of that place, good and bad, and embracing that as part of you, that's going to help us in a good way move forward and to walk lightly on the earth. Because for some reason, we compartmentalize things and we act a certain way somewhere, like in a church, and then we make an ass of ourselves in other places. And we need to pull ourselves together into one whole, you know, and that includes our social movement change theory and learning about this word that they use and abuse right now called intersectionality. Learn about that, you know.
Please, there's many people in the hall. You're going to have to wait. You spoke already at the microphone. Thank you very much. I'm going to try and take a few interventions of the mic. We cannot go too long because the translators usually work for about two and a half hours and we get in there. So please, we'll try and get as many comments as possible. Keep them very brief and then we have to conclude. Please. Yeah, you win.
Hi, thank you very much for coming to speak to the panel.
Speak in the mic so we can hear.
Okay. Thank you all for coming today and speaking. Given that Israel is a leader in green technology, I believe they recycle 80% of their wastewater and obtain 40% of their water from desalination. Where do you envision their role being in the movement to combat climate change in the developing world? And also, is the left willing to work with Israel to affect climate change in the world? Because the loudest voice at this conference seems to be saying no. Very disheartening to see it do.
Thank you.
Well, I have a more critical comment or a question which is also a little bit on the opposition. If I would ask the people or how many people would have come right now without burning fossil fuels from their home here, it would be only 10%. And this man, as well as many others, do have mobile phones and we're using them currently right now. And guess what? These have all been done by international companies. So we do use structures and things all the time, which are actually from what we're again bashing against. And I think, isn't that a little bit honest? Okay. And wouldn't it be better to start with ourselves, not consuming this stuff in order to get there? Isn't that also a way to do so? Because it's a little strange using.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I'm going to take another comment, please.
Je viens de la Tunisie, un pays qui a vu des révoltes.
Bonjour et bienvenue au Canada.
Un pays qui a vu des révoltes il y a 5 ans, des révoltes qui portaient des valeurs de liberté, de dignité, de justice sociale. On a reçu deux forums sociaux 2013-2015. Je suis ici parce que je suis content que les jeunes du Québec et du Montréal se sont battus pour avoir le forum social ici à Montréal. Vraiment, c'était la bonne solution et le bon choix. Mais finalement, je voulais dire que finalement, on souffre en Tunisie, les mouvements sociaux, les mouvements féministes, les mouvements citoyens, les mouvements de droits de l'homme, parce qu'on est réellement dans une double impasse. On est sous une menace terroriste de montée de fondamentalisme religieux. On est aussi sur le diktat néolibéral qui nous impose un minimum d'État. Maintenant, on est au Forum social, 15 ans après Porto Alegre, on est à Montréal. Si on est d'accord que Sanders, c'est une bonne chose, Podemos, c'est une bonne chose, le printemps arabe, c'est une bonne chose, Syriza, c'est une bonne chose. Que faut-il faire alors pour pousser ces mouvements partout dans le monde pour avoir beaucoup de Podemos en Europe, beaucoup de printemps arabe et beaucoup de révolte? Je dirais même que nos sociétés sont réellement déchirées par une crise identitaire au cours de laquelle il y a une crise sociale et d'exclusion économique. Les peuples du Sud demandent plus de solidarité parce que les industries polluantes sont en train de délocaliser chez nous. On va avoir le COP22 à Marrakech, soyons nombreux pour dénoncer ces délocalisations parce que réellement, tous les peuples du terre ont droit à être dans la dignité, dans la fierté et dans le respect de l'amour de la nature et dans le respect des droits économiques et sociaux.
Absolument.
Would you step up to the mic? Thank you.
It seems to me that...
Please speak into the mic. I'll let down the
closer. Is that better? Okay. Seems to me that the point I think we're perhaps we have an oversight on is the coming together to rebuild. I don't want to be a pessimist, but it sounds like we're heading towards the point of no return very quickly. And mobilizing, organizing and mobilizing to rebuild would be the question that I would bring forward in terms of intersectionality and how you plan on coming together. We propose an initiative after this forum that would allow us to organize, to mobilize, to rebuild. Thank you.
Thank you very much. One last comment because it's getting very late for the transition, please.
I hear that we care about the earth and about the people. Solar panel and wind power need extraction, use a lot of chemical, and keep killing the planet. Indigenous people have been living for hundreds of thousands of years in harmony with nature. Our human needs don't need consumption of this earth. I'm wondering why we're not talking about stopping consuming this planet. I'm wondering why I don't hear it in this discourse.
Thank you.
Il reste deux personnes. Est-ce que ça serait possible de finir? Je vais m'entraîner.
Je vais essayer, mais prenez-moi une minute. Si vous gardez votre commentaire, très bref.
Très bref. Alors, premièrement, on a salué les gens qui sont en avant. Moi, c'est Alfonso de la délégation de développement IT. Félicitations, mais on a oublié deux personnes exceptionnelles, fantastiques, qui sont en avant. Ce sont les interprètes en langue des signes. Alors, je voudrais les remercier. Parce que c'est un signe d'espoir également. Pour finir, je voudrais souligner un autre signe d'espoir dont on n'a pas fait partie encore ce soir, dont on n'a pas parlé, c'est le processus de paix en Colombie. Après 50 ans, plus de 50 ans de guerre civile, la Colombie s'apprête enfin à signer la paix. Puis, évidemment, il y a des gens à l'intérieur du pays, puis à l'extérieur du pays également, pour qui la paix, ça ne fait pas leur affaire, alors ils veulent maintenir la guerre telle qu'elle, ça existait auparavant. Alors, nous avons besoin de la collaboration et la pression de la communauté internationale pour qu'effectivement, lors du référendum qui va avoir bientôt en Colombie, la paix soit réussie, puis finalement, on arrive à aboutir dans ce processus-là qui est tant attendu par les Colombiens depuis aussi longtemps.
Merci, camarade. Intervention.
Hello, I'm going to be signing my question. I just wanted to express a struggle that I've experienced and seen, especially when it comes to the deaf community, which is a community I feel as a citizen too. As I view the hearing community and on an international level discuss these issues, whether it be oil, whether it be anything else that's been discussed today, I noticed some challenges. I appreciate the interpreters that have been provided during World Short, during this week. I really salute you. But when it comes to all the actions that have been that you are involved in, that other hearing organizations are involved in, I wonder about the deaf participation in the deaf and hard of hearing world. Because in my experience, there is not very much motivation when it comes to environmental issues or other such like-minded movements. And so I wonder about the opportunities being lost about having more communication between these two communities, because I feel the deaf community is being left behind. I mean, with the unemployment rate being so high amongst deaf and hard of hearing folks, there are many possible job opportunities within this field. And that's only one thing that I feel is being lost when it just doesn't seem like this communication is being established.
Thank you. Monsieur, Madame Comico, un petit commentaire, je vous prie, c'est le dernier, il faut que nous arrêtions. Allez-y. It's the last comment, Victoire.
Sir, I can't
be
very well, so I don't even know if you're talking to me,
no? I don't know, are you at the mic to speak?
Yes, okay. Hola a todos. I'm from Mexico, and I want to ask really fast, your opinion about what's going on with the mining Canadian companies, especially in Mexico, what is their opinion about what's going on there? Because I didn't hear anything about that. So I would like to have your opinion, if there is enough time.
Thank you. There's no time, but I will ask you to agree. I'd like to leave the last word to Naomi tonight. We are so happy and so honored to have her here with us tonight. Thank you very much. Thank you to all the guests. Thank you to the students. Thank you to you. And please, let's give the last word to you. Naomi.
I wasn't prepared for that. Who do I think the last word?
You know, climate change changes everything, but a two-hour panel can't cover everything. We did our best. You know, there were many wonderful points that were just raised just now. I want to particularly thank the speaker who asked the question, who's also our interpreter, about sign language. And I think more broadly, we should be challenging ourselves to do more to include all disabled communities. And that's part of building the most powerful movement that we can. I mean, we sometimes talk about this stuff as if it's like, oh, it's the politically correct thing to do, right? But it's not just the politically correct things to do, it's how we win, right? Because we are up against these forces with a huge amount to lose if we win. What we know, because 350 is the organization that popularized the idea of the carbon budget, dude, and we know that there's 5 times more carbon in those proven reserves than is compatible with life on Earth, which means that if we win, and we must win, they lose trillions of dollars of wealth. So they fight like hell to protect their money, and as Tasha said, it's all about power, right? But how do you build power against the richest sector in the world, the fossil fuel sector and the banks that fund them, right? You build it by building common cause with people who are not just afraid of some abstract future apocalypse, right? But who are ready to build a world that is better than the present, not just worse than some abstract future, but better than the present, right? That's how we build coalitions of people that are willing to fight against those very powerful forces, right? We're not just gonna win this with arguments. We're not just going to build this with moral suasion. We are going to build this with coalitions of highly motivated people who know that action means clean water in their communities, resources for their schools, healthcare. We have spent so much time hitting the so-called bread and butter issues against the environment, and this is what it means to build that intersectional movement. I want to just finish by thanking Roger. Thanking the organizers, the translators, the signers, my fellow panelists who are doing the work on so many different levels of stopping the mines, the pipelines, building the just energy-based transition, building those difficult ties between labor and the environmental movement with all of our fraught history. It's been an honor to share this platform with you. And let's all remember, this is not the last time we get to be in a room together. So thank you very much.
Merci beaucoup, merci Naomi. Merci à vous tous. Thank you. Thank you.
It's Ambassador David Kaham.
How are you doing?
Yar, good.
Yar.
Hell, really? The ambassador? Wow.
Well, how are you doing?
Good. This was great, eh?
It was a great conference. I think, you know, all these conferences, hopefully something good comes out of it, like people get together and
the networking.
Build a movement.
Yeah, does that people pass behind? Yeah, yeah.
Come
on.
Hopefully. Yeah. Yar.
You were here the whole time?
Yeah, I was there. I got in very late because actually there was double the amount of people wanting to come in.
I know. There was a lineup.
The lineup was huge. I got cut off.
I got here 5 minutes before, but my press pass got me through it all.
Actually, I couldn't get in, actually. But I waited around for the around 15 minutes. Mm-hmm. Everybody left, and there were some people who left from the... And there was some space, that's all. Mm-hmm.
Go ahead. No, it's okay. Go ahead. No, it's okay.
So how's the things going everywhere?
Good. Go right in here. Yeah, that's better. We're not in anywhere. We're in a better background.
So I think the LEAP manifesto is extremely important, and to change the system is extremely important. You know,
I live streamed that this morning, but man, McGill has the worst Wi-Fi of any university, jamming equipment. I couldn't get a signal out of that auditorium with my life.
Really?
Oh, it was hell.
There was the double of the amount of
I'm not going to do any. McGill wouldn't let me log on to their Wi-Fi, and I'm media, and I refuse to go to McGill for any more stuff. It's sad. Oh, I hate McGill.
It was
there's a deep history.
I thought I was attending a rock concert, you know? There were so many people that was like double or triple the amount of space that was people couldn't get in. They were really, some people were really upset outside, you know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. They couldn't get in. Okay.
Nice. Okay, I'm going to wrap it up. My name is Dee Shanger and DRR, and stay tuned. We've been live streaming like mad. Hi. For the people's social forum a couple years ago and a few others. And yeah, this is a little overwhelming, but DRR and DRR. Okay, ciao.
No, she wanted to go outside.